Okay, so I'm just going to set this up by letting you know that I've been kind of the moderator, and now I'm speaking. So I'll save you guys the boredom of introducing myself. But what I can guarantee you, and what I kind of saw from Stacy earlier today, is that you're going to get a super technical 30 minutes on LinkedIn paid campaigns. And the reason why I'm doing, yeah, there you go, raise the roof, whatever you want to do. But the main reason I'm doing this is because I'm taking the past 2 years of A/B testing, learnings, failures, and I'm going to present you what we learned over the past 2 years in 30 minutes. So, here we go. You ready? Yeah? I also know this is right after lunch, so just like you, I want to sleep as well right now. So I'm going to make this as energetic as I can for you. Okay, so we are talking about not just paying for pay-to-play, paying for results. So that's something that our executive team wants. That's something that obviously our marketing team wants, something that I want. We're going to put a lot of time and money into our paid campaigns. We better be able to see clear results on a consistent basis, and that's what I'm going to share with you today. All right, so a little bit about me, just so I can give you guys a little bit of clout of what I've been doing. I've been working in B2B and B2C over the past 7 years in social media, and I have not just a passion for social, but really driving an organization's clear ROI with social media. So I don't go into organizations and just, you know, do things on the social channels like we all do. I really have a passion for going in and making sure that we show how social can really work for the organization. And this is one of many, many ways that we do this. I've spoken about organic strategy and all that stuff as well. I know some of the text in this is kind of hard to read. It's kind of intentional. The stuff that's really hard to read, I don't want you to read it. It's more for when you get our slides later on. Those are kind of the best practices that I'm mapping out. But my handle is @iRyanPena in case you want to take a picture of me. But no, nobody will. So moving on. Okay, so I work at a software company, and it's important for me to tell you this because this is kind of why we created the campaigns that we did. Now, I'm going to make sure that when I'm sharing this with you, I'm not talking specifically to software stuff, but I think it's important to understand the challenges that we have as a software company. So MentorMate is a global software company, been around for 15-plus years. They do custom software for companies all over the world, and I manage that brand. And the problem with that from a marketing standpoint for social media is that we can't actually talk about the products, the software that we make, because our clients don't want us to say we made it, NDAs and things like that. So you think about, you have a product that you make. I can't tell anyone to go to the app store or go on the web or look at this portal because nobody wants us to talk about it. So we can't actually market our end result product. And that's a big challenge. So what we decided to do as a marketing team is sort of rethink our marketing strategy and focus more on the talent that we have. We have over 400 employees in our organization globally, a lot of developers, a lot of designers, project managers, et cetera, and they know their stuff. So really highlighting best practices in our industry is what we focused on with our content marketing, and that ties into paid campaigns on LinkedIn and elsewhere. So we really want to give people value-added tools that they can use to know best practices in the software industry. Through that, they're learning about our company, and then through that, hopefully they'll become a client. Okay? So MentorMate, really quick getting through these. Kind of cool. They have 7 offices globally. This is our office, our front door in Minneapolis, is where I'm from. And we have also offices in Europe, in Bulgaria. This is actually a drone shot that I took earlier this year in Bulgaria, in Varna. This is our office. I'm taking this because I wish I worked here. That's the Black Sea that you're seeing. So this is a pan to the Black Sea. Yeah, can you imagine working at this office? There's a club right here, a beach right up there, and then the Black Sea. It's just ridiculous. Anyway, that's one of our 7 offices. Our office in uptown Minneapolis is just an office. We have a beautiful view of the road. It's fantastic. All right, so let's jump into it. So ROI, right? So we always, over the years, we want to know how to show ROI for what we do. And I really feel that there's different stages in ROI, especially with social, and specifically to paid campaigns. So let me share a few with you. All right, so we started when I started with the organization 2 years ago, there was absolutely no ROI of social media. We weren't doing anything with paid. We weren't doing anything with organic that was successful. So we came in and we focused on site visits, right? It's a kind of a general starting point for ROI. We're going to use social media to drive more people to our website. That makes sense. So we had a baseline of very small amount of people that would go to our website on an annual basis, and we've more than quadrupled that over the years. So year over year, site traffic grew. We then shifted from that and kept that going, rather, to the next phase of ROI, which was contacts, or some of you might look at those as leads, people that we can then add to our nurturing workflow, people that we have email addresses, names, potentially phone numbers, that otherwise didn't exist in our database. So this was where kind of the light bulb went off, and this is also something that started out with a challenge, but we made it into a huge success. When I started in 2015, I started near the end of the year, and we only had for the entire year 48 contacts or leads that were created from social media, or at least tied to social media in our tracking. Then in 2016, after spending a whole year of a combination of paid and organic, most of these coming from paid, you can't see the number maybe, but it went from 48 to over 1,000 that second year. So then all of a sudden, everyone's looking like, how is this possible? What's happening here? We'll talk more about kind of where they sit in the funnel later on. But this year in 2017, we're trending to be beyond 2,000 for the entire year. So we're seeing a lot of momentum with this. We've basically been tweaking over the past 2 years what we've seen work, and that's what I'm going to show you, the final results of the best type of campaign that we're running right now, the best performing campaign, and all the little things that we have to think about to make the campaign run like we want it to. All right, so that's where we're at right now. We're pivoting from that and getting even more granular for the next level of ROI success, which is going to be the creme de la creme, the opportunities, actually taking our contacts that we're getting into our database and converting them to actual opportunities where they are talking to us, they're inquiring about potentially doing business, taking on a multi-$100,000 project with us to create some software solution for them. So that's our next stage. And obviously there's other ways that that's happening, but not with social media right now. So we recognize that social media is sort of in the top of the funnel. It's been living up there. A lot of the things we do are kind of awareness and brand building, but now we're gonna start to work our way down the funnel with some other tactics with paid. So now that we have that, let's get into how this all goes down. Campaigns. All right, so I will walk through 4 best practices for campaigns, but just know that we're gonna actually show you screenshots of those best practices so you'll be able to see them. So the first one is actually from LinkedIn. I have a contact at LinkedIn, and they keep iterating this over and over again. When you do a campaign, and what I'm talking about is not ads. Let me be clear, I'm not talking about ads on LinkedIn. I've never tried it, so I can't say if they work or not. I'm just hypothesizing that people don't give a about ads. They want to see something that is meaningful to them in a place that they consume information, which is in their LinkedIn feed, right? So these are in the feed, these are sponsored posts. Think of them as sponsored posts. And when you're doing that, you're building out a campaign based on sponsored posts. So the first best practice is you want to have 4 versions of a post for your campaign. The reason for this is if you do any more than 4, because you can have a lot of them in there, if you do any more than 4, the algorithm doesn't work. It doesn't give you the best bang for your buck. So 4 is the best. And I like 4 too, not only because LinkedIn's saying don't do any more than that, but it gives me 4 ways of testing very slight tweaks in a campaign to see which one is getting more clicks from people, which one is a higher conversion rate, which you don't want. You want a lower conversion rate, et cetera, et cetera. So I want 4 versions. You want to always use an image. This is kind of a no-brainer in today's world. You know, visual is always better, tells a story, it causes people to take pause when they look at a visual. So you might think that, well, today, you know, there's a lot of links that provide a visual preview. Yeah, but people are smart enough to know that that's a link, and they may not be as savvy as just seeing something that's an image that tells a story. The images in the campaigns are clickable, just so you know. So you can have a flat-out image, call to action on the image, small amount of text, and it's still clickable. Crafting the post, the call to action, the 1 or 2 liner, hopefully 1 liner, is you want to ask a question to engage the person that you're speaking to or hopefully speaking to. So ask them, for us it would be like, what does good user experience design look like? And then we would link to our resource, which is a UX design ebook. So we ask them a question, like, yeah, they're thinking like, well, I wonder what that is. Or do a how. So how to design to keep your users engaged in your mobile app. So obviously I'm talking about our industry, but that's examples of how we've done this in the past. So you'll see in the examples that I'll share that the two best performing ones right now, they actually don't start with how. I think one starts with a why. So even though this is the best practice of what we've seen work time and time again, there's always instances where you have to iterate a little bit to make something work for your audience. And then finally, again, no surprise, but you want to make sure you keep those things short. So those posts should be one-liners if possible, or two very short statements. Okay? So those are kind of the basics to get started. I think the biggest one you're going to spend time with, and you should, is the four versions. And so what I'm talking about this is like you might tweak the image slightly on one version. You might tweak it again slightly for another version. You might tweak the copy a little bit with a how or a why, or you're asking a question. So all these are going to be slightly a little different, but they're the same kind of call to action. Okay, so once we have those done, we go into audience. So by now, you've actually loaded your content essentially into the campaign builder on LinkedIn. Now you're actually building out the audience, who you want to target. This is why you're paying the money that you're paying. Yes, LinkedIn is one of the most expensive paid platforms for social, but it's because it works really well for B2B organizations. So, location is the first one. And we started broad with this. This is why we were getting so many site visits, so many contacts, because we do work with most of our clients in the US, so we targeted the entire US. We also targeted Sweden because we're expanding into Sweden right now. So that was our, for most of this year, that's what we've been doing. Now what we're doing is we're getting more granular. So we have some more expansion potentially happening maybe in Chicago, and then we have a lot of business that we actually get in Minneapolis just because we're there. So we're targeting Minneapolis, Chicago, and Sweden right now. So we're getting even more granular because our goal, again, like I talked to you about the last stage of ROI, is we want to make sure that we are able to convert some of these contacts and work with our sales team. I think someone mentioned that earlier today. I think Bernie was right here this morning saying, you know, you got to work with your sales team. So we're working with our sales team with some of these new contacts that we're getting to make sure that they have enough ammo to reach out to these contacts that are downloading our content, filling out a form, and setting up an in-person meeting with them because we actually can do that. So we can't do that all over the U.S., but we can do that in these locations. So location is important. Spend time with that. Seniority, you'll see a section in there. So there's a lot of sections you can complete. I'm pointing out the ones that I think matter most and you're going to get the most ROI from. Seniority allows you to target the title of the individual. So we basically look at C-level, management-level decision makers that would essentially want to consume our content, but would also potentially be the ones that we would work with. They're the ones that would have a budget that they would be able to tell us, and you know, this is what I have to work with, what can we do with that? So spend time on that. Skills make sense. In there, you can go in and basically add a ton of skills of the individual, what the individual should have as far as skill sets. That way, those people are being served your content and not someone else that wouldn't care anything about design or software or whatever it might be. So you want to make sure skills is filled out. And you're going to see examples of this in the next few slides, so I'll show you what I'm talking about. And then finally, company size. It's pretty straightforward, but for us, we work with all types of companies, small companies, large organizations, enterprise, so we basically have them all checked, but they have company size ranges, so if your target audience is a large company, mid-size, whatever, you can kind of select that. Any questions so far? Yeah, so full transparency, I worked in B2C before, but I wasn't doing paid in B2C, so no. And this is purely for LinkedIn, so if it's, and I don't know the, you know, I know we kind of talked yesterday, but if your organization should be on LinkedIn, I don't know if that's the, I think that's the first question you need to ask. If your audience is truly there, it might be a good thing to test. If you want to test, use some of these things to truly know if it's working or not. But I would do a test in conjunction with other platforms that you're using, just to make sure, like Facebook or whatnot. Okay? Okay, so here's one example. As I'm starting a campaign, I'm highlighting what I want you to focus on. So these are the specific things. So this is basically location, an example. So you can see here, targeting Minnesota, Sweden, greater Chicago area. So those things pull up as you type, pretty straightforward. Then next is audience size, or I'm sorry, company size rather. So again, we work with any company, so we have them all checked, except for there's a section for myself only, which I don't know why you would check that. If you want your ad to be served to yourself, I guess, maybe. And then we have seniority. So this is an example. So it's owner, manager, director, CXO, which means any C-level executive, VP, or anyone in a senior position. This is literally all the leadership type of positions. You don't have to remember this because as you type it in or you go to the list, it'll show all of that and you can just check the ones that you want. All right, so there's still more to the campaign, and that's around targeting. So you want to target your audience, obviously, and there's a sweet spot. And this is another tip directly from LinkedIn that I truly believe works. So the sweet spot, which you'll see an example of what this looks like in a minute, is between 100,000 and 600,000 LinkedIn members. So what this means is as you're adding in all of your criteria, you'll see a number change on the top right with how big of an audience it's reaching or potentially can reach. And that's the sweet spot, 100,000 to 600,000 LinkedIn members. If you can be somewhere in there, pretty good. If you're a little over, a little under, you probably want to be more a little over than a little under because you're not targeting that many people after 100,000. But that's the target audience. Budget. This is tough for me because the budget struggle was real. It still is real for me. When I started, I had $800 a month spent on whatever I wanted, and that went really fast on LinkedIn. $800 does not go very far on LinkedIn. So I don't know what everyone's budget is here, but speaking from experience, we could not get them to give us more money. So I said, can you let us test something for a few months at $5,000 a month? And I got it, because they knew it was a test and that if it didn't work, they were safe. They didn't have to make a big investment after that. But of course it worked, and so now our standard budget is $5,000 a month for what we're doing. Of course, if we had a lot more money, we'd get a lot more results, and they know that, but we're okay with it for now, and that's kind of our sweet spot. So I'm putting it here. If you really want to see how a campaign can work for you, I would recommend starting at $1,000 for at least to test something out, just to try something. If you can get $1,000 for a week to test something, so you basically have it start on a Monday and run through Friday or whatever, and watch it, that should be enough to actually tell you a story, kind of show you what the data shows. And then daily spend. So LinkedIn will tell you, because they tell me all the time, to just turn it on and walk away and spend a ton of money. We can't do that. We have a very limited budget. So I watch our budget and our LinkedIn campaigns daily. Meaning I take control of how much I'm spending daily. You can put a daily spending limit. I watch how the campaigns are performing with those four different posts that we're testing. I turn some of those on and off. If one's not working really well, I'll turn it off so that way three are working or two are working, or if one's working really good, I turn them all off and let that one perform out of the rest of the week. So you can tweak your campaigns, and the best way to do that, I believe, is with daily budgeting, just kind of watching that budget on a day-to-day basis. Yep, exactly. Load all four. They're running on the same campaign, the same amount of budget, same audience, and then as you're watching it, as you refresh the screen after a couple hours, you're going to start to see, one, you're spending a ton more money on conversion, which you don't want. Another one maybe isn't performing at all, not getting any audience. Then there's one that maybe has a low conversion rate, which is great. It's getting the most amount of impressions and reach, which is great. And so you should start to see conversions from that one. So you might turn off or pause some of the other ones and let the ones that are performing run. So this is an example of the skill. So we definitely spend quite a bit of time. There's no magic number here. I don't know how many there are here for us, but we probably have 20, 25 different skills that we're targeting. People that have these skills would be interested in this content that we're serving them up. But as you do that, you see the magic number change. And all your other stuff that you put on the top, it says 220,000. So we're in that sweet spot of 100 to 600,000. So that's what I'm talking about. And that will change with everything that you add. So even your company sizes that you're targeting, you'll see that number change as well. So you can kind of pick and choose and tweak it to get to that sweet spot. All right. And then the last thing, this is how I manage the daily budget. So at the very bottom, they actually hide this. You have to click to see more because they don't want you to stop it after a while. So you automatically see you have my daily budget at $600, even though I can spend about $1,200 a week, hence $5,000 a month. But I have daily at $600. I'm letting it run at its recommended bid rate. And my total budget doesn't mean anything here because that's just my running budget that I've spent money on this campaign over time. But that daily budget is huge for me because I know it'll stop once it reaches that and I can assess and adjust as needed. Sorry, I'm going a little fast. I want to make sure there's plenty of time for questions. Remember, this is 2 years worth of stuff here. Okay, I'm getting there. Okay, so this is an example of the current paid campaign we have right now. I wouldn't say by any means this is the sexiest post you're ever going to see. Definitely not. This doesn't mean anything to most people in this room, but this is our post. So this matters to our audience. Agile is a way that we do a lot of our day-to-day process management, project management, all of that stuff, how we run our teams, how we run our software solutions. So the image is simple. They recommend not having a lot of text, not a lot of stuff on it. Clear call to action. Again, this free download button is clickable. It'll go to the link that's actually tracked on the top there. And so we have it actually calling out a super salesy thing, free ebook at the top. For some reason, it just works for us. I'm not going to recommend that for different organizations. But just know that it does work for us. If you're in a similar type of company, it might work. They just seem to really like, oh, it's free. I want that resource. And then we have 7 strategies. So this is just calling out a number. It's different from what I said earlier, but it works for this specific campaign. Then the other one that works is, come on. There we go. Why your business needs agile software development with remote teams. So it's kind of why. It's making them think like, oh yeah, maybe I do need this. Why do I need this? And the same call to action link and image, because those work. All right, so you got success. This is great. All right, so we're seeing good conversion. This is usually where the ROI stops for most people. But this is what we're going to start testing. We're already starting this past month. It's working, and we're going to plan to continue this into 2018. This is the part where we're taking what we're getting, and we're starting to work with our sales team. So this is how we're doing it. All right, so some tips on how to take your stuff further. You want to scrub through each contact. Now, this sounds kind of crazy, but we're so focused on what we're trying to get. We want to get such good ROI. We want to get such good contacts. That's why we have all those skills in there. That at the end of the week, we end up getting about 25 to 30 new contacts that come in, that download this ebook, that fill out a form in our new contacts in our database. So what I do every Monday is I scrub through the previous week's contacts we use HubSpot, so whatever CRM database. So we're able to find through social media, through our tracking, we're able to find them. They came in that time frame last week. And what I do is I do these 4 things. I scrub through each. I only review business email contacts. So if they supply their personal email, not looking at them. But if they supply their business email, great. I find them on LinkedIn. This is manual. But I'm thinking about, like, I want to take our ROI further. So I spend maybe about 30 minutes doing this every week. I find them on LinkedIn. I search for their name that they provided to us. I add their company right after their name at the search. And that's when I find it. If they pop up, boom, I got their link on LinkedIn. I put it into HubSpot. Can't see it. You'll see it in a second because I think I made a video of it. If it'll play. It's just me scrolling through HubSpot. So this is a guy from Saab that we got, Saab Automotive Company. He has his emails at the top, Saab Group. Came from LinkedIn. You can't really see that. And then, so we're really excited about that. We assign it to the salesperson. We put the LinkedIn link in the CRM database, a quick note about why we think this is a good candidate. And then we save it. And that's spoon-fed to the salesperson, the person that's in that area. And that's all they need. There doesn't have to be a conversation every single time. They come into work on Monday. They have these contacts at the ready in addition to other people that they're targeting. So that's really how we do it. It's a bit manual. But again, I want to show how we can take and bring what we're getting at the top of the funnel down to convert to opportunities. And at the end of 2018, our goal is to say that these companies that we're working with right now are from social media. Like, they're paying us hundreds of thousands of dollars to partner with us, and they came from social media. Right now, we are rocking the brand awareness. We are rocking having them in the automated sales or automated marketing funnel of automated emails, all that good stuff. But we all know that that only works in the masses for a small percentage of people. So that's that. Before I move on, any questions about this? Because I know this is weird. It's not like what you hear a lot about. Yeah, so one over here, one over here. Go ahead. Yeah, good question. So we had 30, we scrubbed them. We ended up with maybe 5, 7 at the most, really good contacts. And we point out that this is a person from Minneapolis, a person from Chicago, and our Chicago team takes care of it. There's a person from Sweden, our guy in Sweden takes care of that one. So they get their own. So there's 5 or 6, but each person only gets just a couple every week. What was your question? Yeah, it's a good question. So the question was, did we provide the download? Was it just a teaser of what we do or what is? So the ebook is something that we create as a content. I don't create it, but our content creator does this about once a quarter. They pick a specific industry topic that we've done some SEO research on. We kind of see that there's a demand for this resource. And we create a 40-page ebook. So it's chaptered out. It's very visual. There's text in there. We're kind of mapping things out. But it is a resource that is very useful to that audience. So it could be, like I said earlier, a UX design resource, how to do good user experience design and why that matters for a mobile app. Or it could be why you should think about cross-platform development, which means nothing to most people in this room, but it's a huge thing for that audience. So it's a deep dive into a specific topic. And a side note, the content team also creates blogs every single week based on those chapters. So it's like a tease. That's like a small teaser. And through that blog, it links to the ebooks to learn more. And then we get forms from that. So yeah. Yeah. How useful is this without CRM? Ooh. So you have a website. So you have Google Analytics, right? So the contacts, if you're doing tracking, which is going to be the next thing, it's kind of extra credit. If you're doing the right type of tracking, you should be able to see these contacts filed in under social media through your campaigns. There's just a little bit more manual of a process at this point. So that stuff's coming in through your Google Analytics. You dig in, you'll see with email contacts, direct contacts, social media. You should see social media in there, and then you'll be able to see the contacts. Then that manual process is, again, searching for them on LinkedIn if you have it, maybe creating a spreadsheet, and that's something that you share with your sales team to then take action on. Who the people are. And we also put in what ebook they download it so we kind of know what they're interested in because it varies. So it's a little bit harder, but it's possible. Okay, so like I said, extra credit. Stacy mentioned this. I'm sure some other people mentioned this. Campaign URL builder. So tracking is awesome. We track all the time. There's various ways of tracking with tools. Bitly, we know we'll track clicks and various things like that. But I'm bringing this up because, honestly, it just is, for us, is the best way that we've been able to track and see for each campaign how they perform, and we know that it's coming into social media and it's not going into the dark space of the internet like dark social. There's this stat that 70% of your social media posts go to dark social, meaning that it's not categorized as a social media site visit or a social media contact. It goes into direct. Which, what does that mean? Nobody knows. So this is based on not having tracking or, you know, the person that clicked on it is under a work firewall or they're incognito browsing, whatever it might be. So campaign URL builder is something that Google makes. It's actually, it's a form that they have on their website. I'm sure there's people out there that have an Excel spreadsheet that they've made a formula that does this. But basically, if you Google campaign URL builder, and some people call these UTM tracking, you'll be on a form that looks like this. You paste the link of where you're sending them to. So if you think your LinkedIn campaign, you're sending them to this ebook download page, for example. You paste the link in there. You add in your criteria. So you add in this is going to be medium. Or I'm sorry, this is going to be LinkedIn is going to be the source. The medium is going to be social. By the way, this is all on my deck that you'll get access to. And then you can put the actual campaign title. So I'm doing a test on Agile or whatever. So that way, if they click on it, what's happening is it's taking all that information, it's making a super long link, mentormate.com/blah blah blah ebook/, and then a bunch of weird things after that. That's the tracking. So If you do that, then you actually will know, A, LinkedIn will tell you how your campaigns are working, but B, your data in your CRM or your Google Analytics will show you not just that you got so many people in social media as a category, but also what they actually took action on. So each specific campaign can have a different campaign builder link. So just check it out. It's not anything you pay for, which is why we use it, because we have no money for that stuff. Okay. Yes. Okay, so define your ROI. So these are just kind of quick recaps before we spend the last 10 minutes of questions. So again, I think it's important, like I said in the beginning, define your ROI, make sure that you understand, and you also communicate to your leadership team the ROI that you're focused on now and how showing the wins of that ROI is going to set you up for future levels of ROI. Because of course, your leadership team is going to come at you and be like, how can we see social media give us a paying customer? That's what they want at the end of the day. And social media at its core is designed to build more brand awareness, to get more awareness of people through organic and various things. I mean, when we're putting out a campaign on LinkedIn, these people aren't following MentionMate. They don't know anything about MentionMate. They never heard it. Most people in this room never heard of MentionMate. That's normal. But when we put a little bait out there with our social media campaign, we throw our fishing line way out of our funnel. It's a super long line. It's going way out there. Someone bites on it, they still don't know anything about MentionMate because they're not in our funnel yet, but they want that content. They want that resource. And so then we're slowly reeling them into our funnel, and it takes forever because it's such a long line. I don't know if this analogy is working. I'm just going with it. Long line. And, you know, they get an email, and then the line breaks. I'm done with it. Okay. So anyway, the point being here is we know that we're getting this huge thousands of contacts every year now, which is great. We went from 48 to thousands. But they're just floating out there. They still don't know much about us. So what we're doing now is we're taking any new contacts that we're getting, and we're like, we've got some crazy fishing line in there that's super strong and it's super short. We're reeling them into the funnel, and we're making sure that they're in our area, that we can actually meet and talk with them, meet for coffee. We don't mention the ebook. We don't say, we know you downloaded that ebook. We were tracking you. No, we don't say that. The sales team is smart enough. They know that they're just going to go and say, you know, hey, I saw you on LinkedIn. I really like what you're doing in the space. I think we have a lot in common. Let's grab a coffee. Through that, they'll start to do their thing. So define your ROI. Three things here, I believe. Next, make sure that you spend time creating masterful campaigns. So the good thing about this is if you spend the time up front creating a campaign and really thinking about those four different tweaks, thinking about the image that you're working with your design team, or if you're doing it yourself that you're making, all of that stuff, when you turn it on, watch it closely, tweak it, because what we end up doing is we'll have the first week that we go live with the campaign, we're turning on and off, we're kind of watching things, we find two that work really well or seem to work okay. We'll take those two things, the next week we'll create a new campaign, we have those exact two things, but we add two more things that are similar to that to test four new campaigns. We let that run, see what happens. And then at that point, we have our super optimized campaign where one or two are working all the time. And that's what we're doing with the Agile one that I showed you. Okay, and then last thing here is, you know, when you're ready, take that success further. Find creative ways to work with your sales team, and they're going to want to do more with what you're getting. Okay, so I saved about 6 minutes. Questions? And so that's a good question. It's more on the sake of what we can handle manually. That's really it. So it's not to say that we're not doing anything with those personal email contacts, because they are in our automated email nurturing workflow that we've created. So they're getting something from us. But we just don't have enough information on them, to be frank. They usually don't provide their business, their company name. So we just have a first and last name, and a lot of times, honestly, they provide some kind of crazy names that aren't their real names. So it's just, we just don't look at those as quality contacts for our business purposes. I think your point is there still might be something to do with it. We're just not there yet. That might be the next level for us for ROI down the road. We are, but it's optional, because we want to keep the form as simple as possible. The mandatory fields, first, last name, email address. Business is optional. Yep. We found that we've got a lot more context from that kind of A/B testing. What else? Yeah. Yeah, so that's a good question. So to be honest, our stuff that we do is not very sexy. I mean, we make software, and it's great. It helps move businesses forward. But what I mean by that is it doesn't create conversation on social. So the ones that I showed you, you might have noticed it got a bunch of likes, which is great. But if I would have screenshot it below that, you might have seen one comment. So believe me, if we get a comment, we are all over that because we never get comments. We're like, oh my gosh, by the way, I like your hair. Your profile picture is amazing. Just kidding. We don't say those things. But we do try to nurture those comments because I do think that that helps build more awareness in our campaigns. Is that what you're asking? Yeah. Yeah. Say that again if you ever tried. Yeah. So like meaning that you take it out of just paid and more organic? Ah. So we did this with SlideShare. We just basically made a PDF, put it in SlideShare. We saw thousands of views or, you know, SlideShare views, but we weren't able to, didn't tell us a story. Like, we didn't get any context out of it. There was not any comments or engagement on the SlideShare. There was a handful of shares from it that we saw analytics on, but I guess the data just didn't show us enough ROI to keep kind of doing that. And we also, because we were doing it, we felt that people were getting smarter of like, oh, I don't have to fill out a form. I can just go to SlideShare. So it's not to say you shouldn't test it, because I think every audience is different, every business is different, but it didn't work for us. We got time for maybe one or two more questions. I did. That was just yesterday. Because I do everything. I mean, I'm sure a lot of us do most of everything with social media. I missed a day. Shame on me. I missed a day in my travels. So I'm like, I got to spend some money. So I put in $600 for the day, and boy, did we get a good handful of context from that. So that's what that was. Yeah, but I do spread it out. And actually on that note, and I can't speak to, you know, like if there's posting times and things, just so you know, we're thinking about how our potential buyer, we think about even like where they're going to consume that ebook. They're likely not going to consume it on mobile. Even though a lot of consumption is done on mobile, they're not going to want to download a 40-page resource and read through it on mobile. Maybe they would, maybe a few, small few would on the bus or something, but most of our downloads come from desktop because they're at their office. They're thinking about this solution that they need. They're thinking about this thing that they need to understand. So we also focus on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. It seems like our campaigns perform the best because I think Mondays overload. There's meetings. Everyone wants to talk about everything. Everyone's talking about their weekends, whatever. Tuesdays, Wednesdays seems to be more focused for us, for our audience. And then the latter part of the week, people just give up, I guess. They don't want to learn anything. So I don't know, because we've tried it. We've done it all every single day, and we just see a spike on Tuesday and Wednesday for us. So that's my time. I actually have to leave and catch my flight and go back. So on behalf of the summit, everything, I want to thank you for being here, but also thank you for spending time with me over the past 30, 40 minutes. You guys are great. That's it.